Surprise!
Born of two cultures, out of place in both, Issa Noguchi reshaped stones and paper till he made a place he could call his own.
Maybe I'm against sculpture. I mean, I'm more interested in the spaces, really.
Your environment is your sculpture, your world. And the world then becomes a sculpture.
Discover the many worlds created by an Irish-Japanese-American master, Issa Noguchi.
Life passes, cherry blossoms are blown away, but art and life remain.
Thursday night at 8. The following program contains language and subject matter that are adult in nature. Viewer discretion is advised.
POV, celebrating 10 years of independent points of view from America's independent filmmakers. Next on POV.
A 22-year-old rap musician was shot and killed yesterday morning.
Filmmaker Michael Smith gets behind one senseless loss. How loved ones carry on now that Jesse's gone. Major funding for POV has been provided by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation to increase public awareness of independent film and video, the National Endowment for the Arts, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by annual financial support from viewers like you.
I did this film because I'm a young black man, and I had this concern for what was going on with other young black men in this country. You know, we get the statistics every day of the high death rates, young black men killing themselves in the streets. But I knew that there was more behind the story of the statistics than the fact that we were just dying or murdering each other. These are people who had, you know, lovers. They've had mothers, fathers, sisters, aunts, uncles, children. And I just felt that the real story, the real tragedy of what was going on really lied with these people who were left behind. And I just kind of felt, you know, obligated to tell that story. The family in this film really, it became very important to them, because one of their concerns was that their son was being represented in the media as just another statistic. They understand what the media is about, that it can't, you know, deal with every individual person. But for them, Jesse wasn't a statistic. He was someone they loved. He was someone that was, you know, breathing, you know, who lived, who loved, who cried. This was a real human being. So this film allowed them to tell the story of their son with more dimension, with more humanity than, you know, 30 seconds, a minute and a half on the nightly news could ever do.
The following program contains material which some viewers may find disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
With the flashy style, man. Now wiggity whack, but diggity dick, 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 damn. They're bringing it back, back, backing it out of the pack, pack, sacking it out of the sack, sack for the sparky track. I pop a tick, tack. I have no need to jock, cause I be strapped through, killing me softly. Get down now, baby girl, get off me. I'm the one in the front of the left, who's up under the wheel. Turning up the bass, tell me how it feels. 11-5, good, soul food, good. I rarely say it's bad because it turns out good. See, I can walk in the house and throw the gat on the shelf. I gotta stay on the hold, just see the dank. I sell it self-contained, self-maintained, self-proclaimed, I'm done. Cause after this growing, I usually end up drained. Like I say, keep the rhyme flow funky. Follow it from the front lines, you know, nobody pumped me cause the dinosaurs pick the sores, rhymes don't carry G. They gotta be rough, rugged and real to spill me. You feel me? So deal me the cards and put your guard up. Hick up in the style without a scar, I could choke you. Roll you like a 20 sack and smoke you. Tote you like a doobie, use you like an old school and float you. Straight to the four-way, mate. I'm from the five. Live. DJ Lil.
Tonight we begin with the story behind what will be recorded as Oakland's 108th homicide of this year. It happened early yesterday morning. A 22-year-old rap musician whose first album was just about to be released was shot and killed while just sitting in a car with some friends. Police believe it was a case of mistaken identity. Faith Fancher joins us now with the story. Faith.
Thank you, Elaine. This is the story about 22-year-old Jesse Hall, a man who wanted to make a difference with his life. But on the brink of what appears to have been a very promising career, someone with a gun took away Jesse Hall's dreams and his life.
I just want to feel him one more time. I want to feel him feeling me, you know. That's all I want. And that's something that's been taken away that I'll never have again. I'll never have that again. And you can't replace it. It's gone.
Well, rocks is my pillow. Cold ground is my bed. Highway is my home. So I might as well be dead. I walk and walk. Seems this road don't have no wind.
The whole situation was sloppy. And that's what a lot of people think makes them men, when they can go up and smoke somebody. But the whole thing is, you didn't smoke them while they was looking at you. Growing up the way I did, I done bumped into two brothers, two different types of brothers. People who had hearts and people who didn't, those who just didn't give a fuck. And for you to go and shoot a car of people up late at night and not to know who you shooting, you don't have no heart. And sometimes, if you don't, when you do something to somebody and you don't know who you did it to, it wouldn't have an effect on you. Wouldn't have an effect at all, because you didn't know that person, so you had no love for that person. You had no feeling. All it takes is the snap of the clip and the pull of the trigger. Boom, it's done. I hit a corner, I think about it for a minute and go on about my business and don't trip off of what just happened. That attitude in the hood is just to move on.
How do you feel knowing that the person who killed Jesse, this person who has that attitude that they don't give a fuck? How do you feel about them just, they're there, they're still walking around? Maybe they're dead, you don't know. Maybe they might have caught theirs, because we don't know who did it. But most likely they're around, yeah.
To be honest.
Yeah.
It eats me up just because of the way he did his job. The whole situation was sloppy. And that's what a lot of people think makes them men, when they can go up and smoke somebody. But the whole thing is, you didn't smoke them while they was looking at you. You had to walk up on them and do it. If I found out who that was and seen them, I would look at him and then bust a cap in that ass and feel good about it. Cause I did it straight up without no problem. Your back wasn't turned.
This is Oakland. It has a bad reputation. They say the worst side of town is the east side, which really isn't east. It's south, or just kind of round the way. East Oakland is a reputation. And like any reputation, there's a lot of hype, mixed with some truth, flavored with fear. The East Side ain't no joke. People live here, and they die here. There ain't much more you can say. This is Sobrani Park. It's as far south as you can get on the east side and still be in Oakland. Sobrani Park used to be an orchard until someone had the idea of building some houses on the other side of the tracks. With only one road in and that same road out. This is where Jesse was born. This is where he died. Sobrani Park. One way in, one way out.
Smile constantly. You know what I'm saying? It's always we gonna do this, we gonna do that. We gonna have this, we gonna have that. Watch, watch, watch. You know what I'm saying? Fat smile, conversation, cool. Ain't nothing about the conversation about who doing what on the streets or how it's getting done. Ain't nothing like that. You know what I'm saying? Fuck the streets. We about handling our business. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, we doing that. Fuck what's going on out here. Let's take care of this, because that's what's going to get us somewhere, huh? Huh? You know what I'm saying? Yeah, that's just how it was. More. When I get rich, watch. I'm going to have a house. My house going to be in back of your house. And your house going to be on the side of Mike's house. And my daddy, we just going to have a house to the other side where it's going to be a party every night. We're going to have four Rottweilers guarding the house. And man, yeah, that's what we're going to do. Yeah, that's what we're going to do. And pow, it's all gone. You can't have that conversation no more. I don't care how petty people thought the conversation was. It was a dream that could come true. And it took one person to take half of that dream away from you. And that affects you a lot when somebody does something that's ruthless like that, something that's thoughtless, something that's done without feeling. That shit is crazy. It'll fuck you up.
Sometimes I think about, you know, Jesse was so much a part of my everyday life and my future that sometimes I think about, man, all the dirt I did growing up, all the scantling shit I did growing up, you know, just to make a couple of dollars. Man, is this, you know, I know it's wrong, but sometimes I think, man, is this, you know, God's way of getting back? You know what they say, come around, go around? You know, I don't know, man.
Me and Jesse used to talk about grandkids and shit like that. He always said, Mike, I could see you getting old, sitting in an old-ass rocking chair with all our grandchildren around you and you telling them corny-ass stories. You know, because you got that little gift of telling corny stories. He said that shit to me, right? And I was like, man, fuck you, man. You know? And he was like, And I looked at him and I said, where would you be? And he said, I can't see myself that far into the future. I just can't see me. That's a trip. It always took him to say, Mike, I love you. And then it take me a while to let it sink in and say, yeah, I love you, man. You know, kind of mumble it to the side of me like, yeah, blood, I love you, you know? But quit tripping. I was painting it?
Yeah.
I guess I flashed about everything we went through, everything we did, you know. Would he have been doing this for me? You know what I'm saying? And I asked myself that question. It was like, hell yeah. He'd have did this shit for me in a minute. We talked about the issue of race all the time. He always liked to clown and say, hey, Samoan, Filipino, Hawaiian, Japanese, Chinese dude, hey, Mexican dude, come here. You know, he just liked to clown. I don't act.
I'll be Mexican for the day.
Okay. Oh, wow.
I was Samoan yesterday.
No, you wasn't.
Yeah.
Did you hear Mike?
I was Samoan yesterday.
It seems like I come off as being black. If this is what black is to you, then I guess I'm black.
Hola, ¿cómo está?
¿Cómo está, mama?
Hola.
How you doing? When I was getting mistaken for Samoan yesterday, I think it's because I was working out and I had my yokes on for the day.
How
you doing now?
I mean, you ask me, what am I supposed to think about something like that? Something like that, I don't think. I just get heated. You know, if somebody was to sit there and pick up a paper and read, oh, Jesse Hall just got slain today, ain't shit, that's just another dead nigga, I don't know how I'd react. If I had a gun in my pocket, I'd probably blast that person for just talking that shit.
A lot of people, I'm sure everybody you talk to, gonna tell you they had a negative thought at one point in time after they found out exactly what happened. And your thoughts are gonna stay negative when it comes to the story of Jesse, because you really don't know.
Is that negativity or is that just pain?
That's a question you can ask yourself. Is pain positive or is it negative? To me, it's negative. When you feel good, then you know that's something positive. That's something that helps you to smile. But when you hurting, that's not no type of positivity. That's pain, which is negative. Don't feel good. I ain't never heard of anything called good pain. And I ain't looking for good pain. Damn.
Only God knows. And maybe one of these days we'll understand it.
But what is there to understand? You live, you die. Understanding don't take away the pain.
You gotta have hope. If you ain't got hope, you're lost. Somewhere in that head of you, you got to have hope that it's gonna get better.
Music, you know, kind of nullifies shit. You know, that's my escape. You know, some people have, you know what I'm saying, dope. Some people have females. I don't count on either one. I count on the music. Music soothes me. If I'm not delving into music, you know what I'm saying, I tend to get caught up in the daily, like, strifes, you know what I'm saying, of life. You know, so the music helps me maintain, you know what I'm saying. Also, I want to be tight. I got to do something productive, and I can't stand a fucking 9-to-5. I can't stand selling dope. I can't stand that shit. You can only last so long doing that, so... You know what I'm saying? I didn't already did all that anyway. So it was like, the only thing left for me to do is just to master this music shit and try to be like Quincy Jones or some motherfucking body. You know? Plus, I gotta let them know about my folks, you know what I'm saying? About Jesse. You know? Because if it weren't for him, I wouldn't be here.
He's silent now.
When I see Jesse in my dreams, you know what I'm saying, he's telling me, yo, Poke, you know what I'm saying, you almost there, you can do this, you know what I'm saying, I believe in you, I've always believed in you, I'm saying, you gotta believe in yourself, you know, trust that, if you can't do it for you, do it for me.
Jesse and his crew called themselves the Hobo Junction. The Junction is still here making music. If not for themselves, then for Jesse. See, it's about maintaining. It's about love.
If a brother ain't got no love, if he doesn't love himself, if he's not receiving love from anybody, you know what I'm saying? He's lost. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Because without love, love is that strength to go on and persevere, even though shit's fucked up. Without that love, you know, your reasoning is gonna say, well, fuck it. They don't give a fuck about me. Why should I give a fuck about anybody else? The dirt that's out there that could possibly be done, it won't seem as hard to do or as evil as a task to handle if you ain't got no love in the world.
Jesse died because some brother had no love. And the struggle is finding a way to love and not get stuck in the pain and the emptiness. See, that's hip-hop. The world sent in the nigga-fied future shot.
I feel him. I really, truly do. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if it's just my faith or my love for him, you understand me? But whatever the case, I feel him, so, you know. I know he was a part of my destiny happening. he had played a role in my destiny, so he'll always be in my heart. You know what I'm saying? But that's my nigga, man, and I'm gonna let him know that he was special and shit. You know? Like that.
That's it. That's cool.
Right then, I want to find out who killed him and go shoot down. That's the first thing. I guess that's the phenomenal thing.
We went hunting and fishing. I mean, we did all of those things. And I did always, you know, think about, you know, what's my first grandchild going to be? When is he going to give me my first grandchild? Is he going to be married? How is he going to handle things? Is he going to be like these other clowns? Or is he going to be a graphic artist or an engineer?
That come on my mind. But I just kept praying to the Lord because that...
Maybe if I had been here, I might have been out here, and whoever did it wouldn't have did it because I was standing here.
But I just kept praying to the Lord because that definitely came on my mind. I ain't gonna lie. Because the Lord knows it come on there.
I know that it would condemn my soul to hell. How do I feel?
Right then, I want to find out who killed him and go shoot down.
My pastor and a good friend, a deacon, told me that if I seen him, that God wouldn't let me hurt him. And even if God spoke to me then, I think I'd hurt him. I really believe I would. Knowing I'm, you know, I don't think it'd be a good idea for me to see you. Not for me or for my soul.
Right then, I want to find out who killed him and go shoot down. That's the first thing. I guess that's just a normal thing. That come on my mind. But I just kept praying to the Lord because that definitely came on my mind. I ain't gonna lie. Because the Lord knows it come on there. And I didn't want to say that in front of Bobby. Make him go act a fool and get him killed. So, all I could do was pray. If I'd have went and told Bobby, he'd been wanting me to go with him and help look for the guy. And now that would have been wrong, too. Okay, so, I didn't want that to happen. So I had to suppress my thoughts and just pray in order to keep him alive. Yeah.
How'd you get over it?
I don't think I still have got over it.
Do you think you ever will?
Nope. Not until I know what's going on.
The gods are all angry. You heal from the brink.
We know the statistics. It's old news. America is a dangerous place for black boys. Yeah, and you dare we even hope to see them grow up? Not to be doctors, lawyers, or astronauts, but to be alive. Or should we, like a slave mother giving birth to a slave child, let hope be a luxury? Do you feel me? Next to the ocean, you forget the statistics, the life expectancies or the odds. Like in 4 years, one of these boys will be dead. Or maybe the fact that More than one will waste time in a California penitentiary. And the odds are against any completing 4 years at a California university. Watching these boys play, you're haunted by the probability that one will grow up to kill one that looks just like himself.
Yeah, but where can you run? Since there ain't no will of your own. And you know that no one will ever miss you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. When you're finally gone. So you cry. But there ain't no peace on earth, man. Maybe peace when you die. Yeah.
Do you feel me now?
It's late at night, you know, you're just sitting around thinking about, I know you do, because to think about black men, you got to think about yourself, because you're a black man, thinking about how it is that you can kill another man, kill another person, kill another black man. I mean, how do you work that in your life, in your heart? How do you work that with the good that you know you want to do?
Conscience. I always let my conscience bother me. I don't fight it. You know what I'm saying? Because you got to feel the good and the evil in you to decide what's right and what's wrong. And so when I have evil thoughts, I let that goodness come inside, or I even let those evil thoughts scare me to the point to where I have to sit down and think about what could happen, what couldn't happen, what may go right, what may go wrong. You know what I'm saying? To come and make my final decision on what I'ma do and how I'ma do it.
I think I could have waited a little, you know, until I got a little older, but it don't matter now, because people's lives is leaving this earth so fast, it don't matter no more. So I probably don't even know if I'm gonna live to see my kids grow old or whatever, but I always know I had them.
You got the door. And then once that little bit of the door opens, we don't need to suction. You know, I think you'll be able to push this baby
okay.
Out real quick.
Please.
Yeah.
Mimi. Please, can you just help me?
I know, this is a really hard time.
Well, you're gonna do it right.
This is the home stretch. And you're doing a good job of meeting with me.
Yeah.
You're there. Okay,
it's
not there,
but
you're there. Listen, you're there. You just keep breathing the way we've been telling you, and it'll be over before the moment.
Think about it. Just relax.
Oh, I apologize, Tata. Don't cry, okay? What happened to him, that was just unexpected. And anything unexpected like that could happen to me. So I don't know. At least I know that I had kids. And I know that they love me because I love them. Oh, Tata, I'm almost finished.
Once that person who was man enough to pull the trigger can be man enough to admit his wrong, I don't think I'd be satisfied. I don't think I'd be satisfied with even that. Him apologizing. You didn't do something that could be corrected 2 days from now. You did something that affected everybody's life who that person touched.
Mm-hmm.
It's nothing you could do if they get killed in the streets. It's nothing you could do if they get killed anywhere, because death is everywhere, you know what I'm saying?
There's a coroner's identification tag present on the left big toe. That is so, I don't know, but that was so final. Even the doctors coming in telling me that Jesse was dead wasn't as final as reading, there is a coroner's identification tag. You know, that's like, when I read that, I don't know. That's like you would tag a dog, like you go buy tags for your dog, okay? He got dog tags. That's his ID. This is how they ID'd my baby. My baby, who less than 24 hours prior to this was breathing, laughing, eating, talking. He was doing all that.
Ask me not. Oh, gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art called,
you have no reason to feel sorry for me. Did you pull the trigger? Did you take my son's life? Then what are you sorry about? You have no reason to be sorry. What needs to be done is that if you see something going on, stop it. Don't be afraid to say, hey. And even if you are afraid to say, hey, you can dial 911. Now, that's when you should be sorry, if you see something going on and you don't do anything to stop it. You don't have to actively get involved. You can pick up a phone. And what makes it so bad? The call is free. Okay? The call is free. So there's no excuse. And every time someone say, I'm sorry, I ask them, why are you sorry? Did you have something to do with his killing? Do you know something and you're not telling me? Then you should be sorry. Because if I found out that you did know something and didn't say anything about it, you will be sorry. Okay? But no, I understand the people. I know they don't mean any harm in it by saying I'm sorry, and that they genuinely means well, and that they genuinely is sympathetic, or they're feeling empathy for me, you know. And, but I don't need pity. I need Jesse. I need all my children. The night Jesse got killed, those kids came here, and a few of them told me, said, we're going to find out who did this. And when we do, we're going to take them out, you know. This one guy, and I know he done did dirt, right? He said he got in trouble down in Great America. You know how far Great America is from here, okay? Mm-hmm. One night, and the police took him to jail, right? Him and a bunch of his buddies went down there. And he said he called all his so-called friends, and nobody would get out of their bed and come pick him up. And he called Jesse. Now, I remember the phone ringing that night. It was like 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning, right? Jesse got out of his bed and drove to Great America and picked him up.
Have I on earth besides thee?
And he came and he told me that story and he was crying and he said, I swear to you, Mrs. Hall. He said, if I ever find out who killed Jesse, they're dead. He said, they're dead. He said, do you know, Jesse was the only friend I really had. He said, sure, I have running buddies. He said, but as far as a friend, he said, all my so-called friends, not one of them, not one of them came and got me. And they told me they weren't gonna come get me. He said, but I called Jesse. He didn't even think about it. He said, I'm on my way. He said, I'm on my way. And I told him, I said, you know, I said, what you need to do is remember the good things, right? I say, but don't you dare go out and call yourself killing in the name of my child.
Oh, please hear my humble cry.
And this shirt here meant more, and it means more to me than anything in the world. Because, like I told, and when he gave me this, he said, Mama, I couldn't afford to buy you anything, so I made this for you, right? I told Jesse, you know what? I said, it ain't about buying me or how much money you can spend on me. I told him, I said, this means more to me than, I appreciate you making this more so than you going out buying me a shirt, because this is something that you can't replace. And just because somebody shot and killed him, you can't replace that love. You know, that's that love. That love gonna be there. That love is always there. Because the last thing he told me when he walked out this house was, I said, good night, Jesse. He said, good night, Mama. And I want you to picture this, right? Because my bedroom door was closing real slow, and he was pulling the door closed. He said, Mama, he said, I love you. He said, I love you. And I said, I love you too, baby. And I did not realize that when he closed that door, it was like he was closing his life away forever. Because that was it. I didn't hear them words anymore. I couldn't smell him no more. I couldn't feel him. I couldn't do none of it. But that's the last thing he said. He closed the door.
That's why I'm calling, save me a hand. Savior, I want you to please, oh, please hear my humble cry.
You know how they say, gone but not forgot? Not Jesse. He's here.
Not pass me by.
Where do we go from here? It don't matter if Jesse's in the arms of his savior, burning in hell, or alive in our hearts. He's gone. Dead. Dead. And he continues to die in cities across this country. See, Jesse has too many names. In Detroit, he's Jamal. In Oklahoma City, he's Sean. In Atlanta, he's Curtis. In Philadelphia, he's Dante. In Chicago, he's Dwayne. In D.C., he's Anthony. In Brooklyn, he's Amari. In Los Angeles, he's Tyrone. Mother Maya said it best. In these bloody days and frightful nights, when an urban warrior can find no face more despicable than his own, and no ammunition more deadly than self-hate, and no target more deserving of his true aim than his brother, we must wonder how we came so late and lonely to this place. This is Jesse's son at his daddy's funeral. He was 2 then. He's 5 now. America is a dangerous place for black boys. Jesse knew this, and he promised his son that he would be there for him, that he'd love him.
I love you.
Oh, you can't believe
me? One day you're gonna look at this. You're gonna say my dad was like this.
Nah, I'm not a liar.
And this is his brother? Yeah. I love you, man. In my dream come
true. I could throw one of them flaky lines. But I'm not a lying type of person.
My mind is set.
See, if you were my brother or something, I could have said
all. All my goals are set towards making my future better so that I can make yours better.
I'm not that type.
It's just so much I want you to have, so much I want you to know.
What'd you say?
I'm going to start writing, you know, doing something to let you know what's on my mind right now.
It's just flipping stuff.
So when you get older, you'll be able to know exactly what it is.
Let me say some bullshit right quick. What up? Peace, of liquor, love, and justice. It's the AASWAD. I got to say what's up to my little top. He's only about 7 months old right now. And you know, that's how we was chilling back in 1990.
December.
So peace, little bubba. Love, and of course, justice. We out like a bunch of squares. No, we off. Like your last pair of underwear. Out like a Benzy, fleeing a crime spot. Shooting a 9, kill somebody. And yo, cutting it off like a light switch. Your pop's gonna do that. So peace.
I love you, man.
It's 96 when niggas don't wanna box. Use gun skills in the land where plus bills equals more trips to rolling hills. I enjoy life to the fullest, but some things is hard to take. Give a brother a pound one day, next thing you know you at his wake. Not knowing exactly what went down, all I could do is verbalize what I learned. Build the foundation, hold my own ground. Use my musical creations. Put my folks on the train and let them know about my loved ones and the essence of their life wasn't in vain. Nowadays shit is strange. The graphic got my people mind deranged. The enemy smiles in your face and tries to break your back with short change. So I build self of run stealth and pay close attention to devils trying to manipulate me for my wealth. And this transmission contains no fiction in it, no interference, just true to life experience is what I spit.
You know what I'm saying?
All
facts.
Who are the young people behind the statistics and the headlines? How do their friends and families remember them and move forward? The Jesse's Gone website is a gathering place for memorials, artwork, music, poetry, and stories by and about the young people in America who've been affected by street violence. www.pbs.org. POV wants to hear your point of view about our programs and possibly share them as part of our Talking Back segment. Grab a camera and make a homemade video letter, or write your comments and send them to the address on the screen. You can also call 1-800-688-4768 or you can email your comments to pov@pbs.org. Co-presentation of the NBPC. Major funding for POV has been provided by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation to increase public awareness of independent film and video, the National Endowment for the Arts, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by annual financial support from viewers like you. To receive a free viewer's guide to the full season of POV, call 1-800-688-4768.
This is PBS.
Two cultures, out of place in both, Issa Minoguchi reshaped stones and paper till he made a place he could call his own.
Maybe I'm against sculpture. I mean, I'm more interested in the spaces, really.
Your environment is your sculpture, your world. And the world then becomes a sculpture.
Discover the many worlds created by an Irish-Japanese-American master, Issa Minoguchi.
Life passes, cherry blossoms are blown away, but art and life remain.
Thursday night at 8.
Coming on the American Experience.
An unconventional war may require an unconventional truce.
Diplomats talk peace in Paris as bombs rain down on Hanoi.
We believe that peace is at hand.
America searches for a way out on the next Vietnam.
Monday night at 9.